I'm Dr. John Zeisel. I believe that staying engaged in our communities, that continuing to learn, and that knowing we can make a difference, hope, are the secrets of successful aging. Welcome to Hopeful Aging. The mission of this program is to create a life worth living for all of us as we get older, including those with cognitive challenges, by enriching life and offering hope. My guest today is Renée Beard, who is Associate Professor of Holy Cross in Worcester, and got her doctorate at the University of California in San Francisco, did research at Stanford University, and then again at the University of Illinois in Chicago. I have a distinguished guest who is also a sociologist. That's your doctorate is in sociology, which most people don't know. Mine is as well. So we have two doctors of sociology here, and welcome.
Thank you. We're happy to be here.
So Renée, I met you. I actually didn't meet you. I heard you on a little radio clip that I get over the internet, and it said an academic minute with Renée Beard, and I clicked on it. So what do you remember what that was and what the message was? Because that's really why you're here, because I was so moved by the message.
Sure. So in the 200 or something people that I've interviewed over the last, I guess, decade now, who have very early stage Alzheimer's, not early onset, but early stage Alzheimer's, and as I watched them be diagnosed, one of the things I was most surprised about was that many of them were managing actually the symptoms quite well. And even when I would talk to them after they'd been diagnosed, months, years even, they had adapted their lives, and particularly if they had help from sympathetic others who could aid them in that process. But what they were most struggling with was their confusion at how socially stigmatized they'd been. I mean, they didn't necessarily call it that, but how they felt they were sort of less than they had been seen before, less human, maybe, you know, and were treated kind of like what sociologists would talk about as second-class citizens.
And just because somebody labeled them as having this problem.
Right. So they would say, you know, upon diagnosis, all of a sudden the well-intended doctor was talking to their now caregiver, right?
So the doctor you go to the doctor's office with your wife.
Yeah.
And the doctor doesn't talk to you, he talks to your wife.
Right.
About you.
Yes.
In the third person.
Yes. And so as I'm observing this, they would say, you know, everybody all of a sudden treated me differently the minute that word, that label got attached to me. And again, they didn't talk about it as labeling theory. They just said, I don't feel like people value me anymore. And so they felt stigmatized. They sometimes felt that their friends, when they would get the word, didn't want to go out for meals with them, or they weren't being invited over to friends' houses as much as they used to, or go out to dinner or whatever.
Why do people do that? Because they think that it's contagious, or they're afraid, or they don't know, or they don't want it to have to do with them? Or what?
Yeah, I mean, I wish I could say that they didn't think it was contagious, but there were people that felt that even being around it somehow...
It was catchy.
Yeah. I mean, that was a shocking thing to learn. But I think the more sort of accurate way to look at it, or the more common way to look at it, was that people just were uncomfortable around them now. People just couldn't handle, I think we talked about on the phone, like if I were to have a gaffe right now and I were to forget a word, you would offer a word. You would try to help me.
Right.
And that's what we do in social interaction. And they felt that people were so busy calling what they had done in prior parts of their life now a disease, right? That was now a symptom rather than just the forgetfulness that we all sometimes have in everyday life. So they just simply felt that they were relegated, that their status as a person was less.
So we're really talking about the stigma that goes along with the name.
Yeah.
And whether that's a political group or whether that's a cultural group, mm-hmm. or whether that's whatever group it is, they can be stigmatized, and people go, what that really means is that somebody has a prejudice against it before they even know mm-hmm. what it really is. So there's a lack of knowledge, a lack of understanding, lack of
Absolutely.
Education.
Absolutely.
What can we do about this? What do we do? What does the individual do?
Mm-hmm.
And then what do we do as a society to help mm-hmm. improve mm-hmm. the situation?
Yeah, well, I think individuals that are good at appealing to other people's humanity do well. People that would reach across during an interview with me and say, "I'm sorry, did I get that right? Was I wrong? You know, did I say? Do you understand what I'm saying?" The people that would do that, I think, elicit humanity and manage quite effectively. The people that withdraw and are so ashamed or fearful of making these social mistakes that they aren't being, aren't engaged anymore, I think have a much harder time. And I also just think telling your stories, admitting that, sometimes you forget things and have a hard time goes a long way in terms of our personal interactions. I mean, on a much larger level as a sociologist, of course, I think there are really important structural and institutional barriers to having a good life with cognitive issues. I think the media perpetuates the assumption that you get diagnosed with Alzheimer's and then you fast forward to the end stage, you're in the fetal position. That's just not realistic.
So you mean the years between finding out you have a cognitive problem and really being sick are many years.
Yeah, and the best neurologists that I watch diagnose people with Alzheimer's in San Francisco would say, look, you're going to die. This isn't good. You're not going to die of this. Something else is going to get you first, like it does all of us. And so I think people assume you get the diagnosis and then that's it. Life is over. And if people have up to 20 years in between that, what are we doing by allowing that to continue that kind of false representations of the condition?
So when you say media, we're also on media. So mm-hmm. hopefully this media presentation.
Yeah.
Can address that and say, hey,
sure.
Pay attention.
Absolutely.
This is not necessarily
part of why I'm here. I mean, I think that there are a lot of great things, a lot of good documentaries and things like that and films that have come out. But in general, there's such a rhetoric of fear. It's so based in fear as if life is over. And I think that's problematic. I think it sort of robs people of meaningful life.
So the fear is about the future. It's not like today.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like, oh, I'm afraid I'm going to fall down today. It's,
right.
Oh, tomorrow. And what you're saying is that 20 years is perceived of or thought of as like next week.
Right.
And so the fear is not in 20 years, but next week it'll be just terrible.
Right.
I call that the despair narrative.
Right. Yeah.
And, we get that a lot
mm-hmm.
From all sources
mm-hmm.
that it's a downward slope.
Right.
And we have to stop the downward
mm-hmm.
slope.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes, first of all, the slope is always there for all of us. As we get
Absolutely.
Older, there's a slope.
Absolutely.
And some of it's more steep, some of it's less steep.
Mm-hmm.
And our goal is to have a life worth living as long as we can.
Right, right. Right. And there's something distinct about memory, like we're preoccupied with memory, right? So we assume that we can't run a 6-minute mile when we're 60, most of us, right? If we could, right?
I don't run a 6-minute
right?
mile.
But we don't assume, even though we should, that we're going to forget things. Right, I think I talked to you about my sort of filing cabinet analogy.
What's that?
I think of memory. I remember the old-fashioned filing cabinets. I'm going to date us here.
Oh, you mean like pulling out a drawer and files in it?
Yeah, and so that's what I think of the brain as. And you can't store everything indefinitely, right? And so you have to get rid of things. And so we all do this. This is the way the brain works. Any neurologist would talk about it. Probably much more scientifically than
that's
that,
all right.
but you can't store everything, so you get rid of things in the same way that our body declines in certain regards over time and
but
can't go as fast.
What you mean is we get rid of things, we forget things that are less important.
I think so.
No,
and the people
I
talk to would say that, right?
What
they don't forget who they are. They don't forget their life story, although some of the representations indicate or suggest that.
Right.
They forget what day it is. Well, when I'm on vacation, I forget what day of the week it is, too. I forget the date.
I actually don't forget the date only when I'm on vacation.
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes have... Well, the date I never remember, because that's a number.
Yeah, exactly.
It doesn't mean anything.
And you maybe only know it when we were writing down dates, or
that's
if we're sending emails and thinking of dates. But same thing with, we talked about this as well, parking your car. Who has not ever parked their car someplace? Maybe someplace you always park, a parking lot you always park in, and you're not paying attention, and you walk in, and you don't remember where you parked your car, and you walk out. Why is it that we are paralyzed by that fear?
Well, especially when we get older. Because if you're 25 and you do it, you go, ha, 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 I can't find my car.
Exactly.
But as we get to be 60 and 70 and 80, you do that, you go, uh-oh, something's wrong. Right.
Yeah, it becomes symbolic. And one thing that's very clear is when you sort of focus on trying to remember something, you almost always can't. Any of us, again, at any age, you have to, you know, you go into the room and you say, why did I come in here? Well, you go back to the other room and then you remember.
Yes.
But if you just stand there and think about it and sort of, you know, beat yourself up a little bit about the fact that you can't remember it, you get anxious and stress makes it less likely you're going to remember.
It's like when I was in school, in high school, and there would be tests to take, and there were 100 questions. Mm-hmm. We were taught, if you come to a question that you just have the slightest idea, don't worry about it, skip it. Because it's better to get 90 and skip that question than to spend the entire hour worrying about that one question and getting 50.
Exactly. And I think that again, some people are better than others at doing that. But yeah, if you focus just on that one question, yeah, you're gonna fail the test. And this is the same thing I saw in the neuropsychiatric, you know, tests I was watching be administered, is the people that would get really caught up and couldn't stop thinking about, you could feel it, that they couldn't stop thinking about what they knew they just got wrong. Right? And so that would throw everything else off. Right?
So, but those tests, let's talk about those tests for a minute. There are other problems with them.
There's lots of problems with them.
I mean, like the fact that people are different.
Yes,
I mean,
right.
What kind of backgrounds might influence
how someone takes
a test?
Yeah, some of the things that I think are most significant are education level. Right? It might well be that you didn't know, the one that always comes up for me is trellis. Right? That you didn't know on the Boston Naming Test what a trellis was to begin with, or a yoke. Right? Or if English is your second language, if you're not native born
I traveled in Kyrgyzstan once, and the oxen had yokes. But other than that, I assume you meant the yoke and the oxen.
Yes, that's what I meant.
Not the yoke in the middle of the egg.
Good that you got there, because
most people don't know what a yoke is.
So when you see a picture of this, you know, unless you have recently had an experience with it. So I think those sort of things are problem. Whether you're a good test taker, people that are dyslexic, right, are going to have trouble. Right, people that have test anxiety. I can't remember if I told you when we were speaking, but when I went through the whole testing process myself at 27 or something, whatever I was, to understand what that was like. And I have had test anxiety. I mean, I've always been sort of that way. My mom is dyslexic, and so I was socialized by somebody who sometimes uses different words for things, and so my brain always has to sort of make that leap. And so she said something like, you know, if I say an animal that is orange and has spots, what do you think of? And I think I said lion or something like that. Right. Like I knew it, and then I couldn't stop thinking of that. So I think if you're the kind of person that
wants to do well on tests,
you
get caught in that.
Yes. And, or if you used to do really well at math, say, and you recognize that you're not as quick as you used to be. And there's a little test going tick tick, I mean a little talk going tick 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 tick.
Right.
And so the environment, although I think they are well-intended practitioners, is very stressful.
So these tests are supposed to tell you if you have an abnormal forgetfulness. That means that there's something called normal forgetfulness.
Absolutely.
How do we deal with this question of what's normal and what is not normal?
Right. I think that's one of the most challenging things about memory loss, about cognitive issues, is differentiating that line between normal and pathological, because we do all forget our entire lives, right? And so at what point is it abnormal?
And at some points it's functional, as you said, get rid of the unimportant stuff.
Right. And so, you know, I think that... you know, people struggle for those reasons, because, you know, they walk in there wanting, most of the people I talk to, they come to get us to a specialty clinic to get diagnosed because they want to be told that they're normal. They want to be told that this forgetfulness they're having is related to age, and it's not.
Right.
Remember, these are people that grew up in a time when senility was what we now call Alzheimer's.
My grandfather, who lived with us his whole life until he died, we just said, oh, he was senile. Nobody ever said, oh, you're a special...
It wasn't
problem.
A label, right? You get older and you forget things. And so I think that's hard both in the testing, and it's very hard in social life, right? Because I'm a sociologist and I care about sort of the social aspect of it. You know, when people go out into the normal world, their friends will say, oh yeah, I have that too. And so, for some people, that's minimizing the fact that they have this label and they see it as a hopefully manageable medical condition. And for other people, that sort of makes them feel like, well, is this a disease? And so they're asking me, the sociologist, you know, so it, particularly about things like mild cognitive impairment, which at the time I was doing most of my research was just a potential precursor.
There's something called MCI, which is mild cognitive impairment, which is a forgetfulness that might lead to a more challenging behavior or might not.
Right. And that's the problem. And again, people assume the diagnosis, because it's a label, they assume that the diagnosis is going to lead to Alzheimer's. So the people that I talked to who had been diagnosed with MCI reacted and experienced that similarly to the people that had Alzheimer's. They didn't necessarily distinguish that.
And they didn't say, I've got 5 years or 8 years or 10 years before I have to worry about it.
No.
And they start worrying about it right then.
Exactly. And so they didn't have a sense that they might just revert back to normal or that this might be normal for them. Right? If people don't have a baseline, you don't know what's normal. That's where the dyslexics and the English as a second language and the education and all of those, what they call ceiling and floor effects, come in.
A lot of us, whether it's cholesterol or diabetes or or obsessive compulsive disorder, there's a line, that a number in blood pressure, five or seven, and who knows who sets it.
Right.
And above that, you've got it, and below it, you don't have it.
Right.
And so where does this line?
Right.
So there's a term, healthy aging, successful aging. Mm-hmm. Is that normal versus everything else, or how does that fit into this debate?
I've been a little bit critical of those terms only because I think that it implies an abnormal, right? Or it implies an unhealthy and an unsuccessful. And usually it implies that anybody with cognitive issues or mobility, lots of other things,
sure.
but you know, therefore cannot age healthfully or successfully. And that to me is just, that is just unkind. That is an injustice
to
set it up
that way.
Well, it's not
only unkind, but it's also totally opposite to the mission of this program,
which
says to create a life worth living for everybody. Mm-hmm. And let's just take physical disability. You talk about mobility. Mm-hmm. The fact that somebody can't walk very fast or needs to be in a wheelchair, over the last few decades, we've come to realize that doesn't mean they can't be participating in life.
Or can't see well or hear well, right? We don't assume that that means that their life isn't. But there are certain things we do, like cognitive issues, right?
Right. So the level of glasses that we wear, you have not very thin glasses.
Yes.
Have you always worn thick glasses?
I have since
By the way,
was
the green
young.
Is very, very nice looking.
Thank you.
So since you were very young, did you ever, first of all, now nobody says you don't fit into society because you need glasses, right?
Right.
But when you were a kid.
Yeah, I got them in first or second grade. Uh-huh. So I got them. I was the first person in the class to have them. I certainly remember that being, you know, noteworthy.
Four eyes.
Yes.
You wouldn't even say that because it still affects you, right? It still affects us what we were called and what we faced.
Sure.
But in our society, we don't say the degree. You know, there's blind or there's legally blind. And in fact, I interviewed somebody on the station who's legally blind, but he is very productive and is one of the best Alzheimer's experts there is in Massachusetts, if not the country.
Mm-hmm.
And he talked about the fact that his disability affected his empathy.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, here you are not blind at all, but you need glasses, and nobody says you're not successfully aging or you're not healthy aging.
Mm-hmm.
So we only use certain, we stress forgetting or we stress memory so much that we say there's a line, there's above and below, but vision not. Why do we do that?
You know, there are people, bioethicists like Stephen Post or others that would say, or Anne Basting that would say, you know, that we're kind of obsessed with memory. That there, you know, that there's something about maybe in a modern capitalist society that it's the epitome of who we are, right? That without memory, we are not valuable people.
Anne Basting is a colleague of ours who has a program called Time Slips, which gets people of all ages and abilities to tell stories based on photographs, among other things.
And not based on memory.
Not based on memory, and because it's what's in front of them.
Mm-hmm.
And she has a book, which is called, what's it called?
Forget Memory.
Forget Memory.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what she means is the same thing you're saying, which is, let's just forget about memory. We don't need to worry about it all the time.
Mm-hmm. people can still, in her case, and lots of other of the arts therapies, people can still generate things and make meaning and make and have enjoyment without having to remember what day it is or these other, you know, who the president is or whatever it is. And that we have this sort of preoccupation with, you know, time and memory. And I mean, you know, the orientation times three or whatever, time, place, space, whatever, that does us a disservice, all of us a disservice.
Okay, but the research says, you know, 50% of the people over a certain age are going to have cognitive challenges, or 70% or 80%. Why doesn't that mean that a diagnosis should make us afraid?
Well, I would question some of the research. There is very good research that shows that. But what we also know is that you can't definitively diagnose Alzheimer's until autopsy. And when we do those studies, that, like David Snowden at Notre Dame and others have done, we find that we're not always right. And so we have false positives and negatives. And so you have people that live a whole life never being told they have any kind of dementia, and then upon autopsy have the characteristic.
But they never had the problems.
Right. Didn't have the problems. And then the opposite. People that had the problems got the label, suffered what I would consider the sort of psychosocial consequences, and then didn't actually have
physiologically
it
upon, they didn't have
on autopsy.
So what we're really saying is that even if 80%, let's say 50% say they have it, it's a flip of the coin because the other 50% won't get it.
Right.
So, so if everybody's afraid, we got half the population being afraid for no reason.
Yeah, and I would say that the bigger thing is if 50, 60% of us are going to get something, is it a disease? I mean, I would sort of throw that out there. I mean, I think we focus too much. It's too medicalized. We focus too much on it being a disease and then all the label and, you know, consequences that come with that. If half of us are going to have something, I mean, there's not any other thing I can think of off the top of my head where half or more of us are going to get it. I mean, there are people like Peter Whitehouse and others that argue that if we live long enough, every brain would get Alzheimer's,
which
is that a disease?
If everybody's going to get something if they live long enough, does that mean it's a disease?
Mm-hmm.
That's a very important question.
Yeah.
Because, and I use the word condition or I use challenges because, it, you know, to call something a disease is a label that also in many situations is a label decided by some scientists. Or some researchers, or some policymakers.
Right, and as sociologists would say, it's an arbitrary, that line between normal and pathological is arbitrary. I'm not saying it isn't real. I'm not saying Alzheimer's isn't real, but what we call normal and abnormal has gotten, or I should say, what we call normal is getting smaller and smaller and smaller to the point where who is normal? Who that's older is normal in terms of memory? And so I sort of question the utility of increasingly earlier diagnosis, given some of the social consequences that I have learned about through the people I talk
because,
with.
Because, so there's a, as sociologist to sociologist, there's a phrase we use in sociology called the self-fulfilling prophecy. Mm-hmm. And what that means is, and the example I always used was, if I was so worried about not passing a test, I would worry, and I wouldn't study, and then I wouldn't pass the test.
Exactly.
But the same thing can be said for fear. Mm-hmm. I'm so afraid of something happening. I'm not going to go out of my house. I'm not going to talk to people. I'm not going to have friends. And all of a sudden you become lonely and isolated as opposed to engaged in society. So how we label things has those positive or negative effects, and we have to be aware of them.
And, you know, medicine as an institution operates under its own constraints. And so, you know, one of the most common things I saw being prescribed or assumed, rather other than Aricept or whatever, was an antidepressant, right? The presumption that this person will maybe be depressed, or and it's like, well, who wouldn't be depressed? Given the social context of Alzheimer's, who wouldn't be depressed to get the? I mean, it would be a rational
to
response
to be told.
Yes,
you've got a problem. Yeah. It's depressing.
It seems like life is over, right? When I talk to folks, any older folks, they'll say, you know, what two things do I not want? I don't want Alzheimer's, and I don't want to live in a nursing home, right? Those are both what we talk about as social deaths, right? They're seen as social death, right? Like an assumption that you're sort of dead before you're dead, right? We sequester people in nursing homes, and they're removed from the rest. The rest of us, they're often up on a hill somewhere or something, not integrated. It's not age integrated. And the same thing with Alzheimer's. It's assumed, and some of this is the stigma we're talking about, whether it's from the otherwise well-intended doctor not talking to them anymore or their friends, that they feel like they're
they're no longer there. Yes. That people think they're no longer there.
So if you tell me something about myself, I take that attitude on. Mm-hmm. I behave a certain way. My friends and my family start to behave the same mm-hmm. towards me as yeah. if I am that person.
Yeah, and yeah.
And it's sort of I work with somebody whose son just plays. I mean, he's, I don't know, 8 years old or something, 12, and he plays baseball on the local team, mm-hmm. and you know they came in second in the World Series of 8 year olds or
great.
Whatever it was. And I know that that means something to him. So mm-hmm. we gave him a little card mm-hmm. for some, mm-hmm. you know, little gift card mm-hmm. for some Chuck E. Cheese or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And part of the reason I did that was because I wanted him to feel important.
Right.
Because if
right.
you sit up with your shoulders back and you feel important, mm-hmm. people are going to treat you that way, and then you're going to behave that way.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
As opposed to saying, I'm a loser.
Right.
I only came in second.
Right.
And then it just piles on.
Mm-hmm. And because you're a good sociologist, and maybe person, I assume, where you understand the significance of these sort of status passages or this positive reinforcement sort of thing, right? That if that's
right.
significant, the more you sort of acknowledge that, the that reinforces that for that
yes.
that neighbor of yours. That
so I talked about the despair narrative. Mm. The opposite is the hope narrative. And there's a Harvard professor, his name is Marshall Gantz, mm-hmm. who has used this definition of hope mm-hmm. in public policy mm-hmm. and in many areas. And he says hope is defined by YMCAD, you can make a difference. Mm-hmm. And I think the when we give up hope, when we despair, mm-hmm. we go, there's nothing I can do, there's
yes.
nothing anybody can do. Mm-hmm. Whereas if we have hope, we say we can do something about this. Mm-hmm. And what you're really saying is that the stigma of being diagnosed with something mm-hmm. takes away the hope.
Yes, absolutely.
And taking away hope, going back to the mission of this mm-hmm. program, is antithetical to having a life worth living.
Yeah, I mean, it certainly threatens it. It challenges that. But of course, what's so interesting to me is the way in which older people resist. So I think of a couple of things. The first is I wrote a piece with someone named Jenny Noss and her husband, Don Moyer. And Jenny had early onset Alzheimer's and sadly passed away a few years ago here. But she would refer to it as a manageable disability. She just said, you know,
sure.
it's manageable. I could, and you know, she was one of the early people that really spoke very passionately and strongly to me about how, you know, people need to focus on what's left, not what's lost.
Right.
Right. We all are losing things all the time as we age. Why are we so focused on that deficit narrative? Right. And the second thing is one of my favorite quotes was a woman who said to me, you know, I'm still me. It's just that now I'm me with Alzheimer's. I think
right.
she said, now I'm me with AD or something like, you know. And so, you know, again, it's that same thing. Why do we focus on the negative, right? Why do we take that hope? Why do we, you know, and how is that about us and not about them? Not about
so,
what they really
so let me turn that around and say, why do we focus on the negative?
I think it's because of our fear. And I think we're socialized through things like the mass media, right? And the Hollywood movies, you know, and some of the things we talked about in the books and these things. And I also think, you know, well-intended places like the Alzheimer's Association or otherwise who are trying to raise awareness and get money need to spin it in a certain way. And so it that tends to perpetuate or reinforce this tale of tragedy kind of telling of memory loss.
So in terms of getting money, it's to work on a cure, but
sure.
also to do support groups and other good
right,
things.
Right, absolutely.
But what you're saying is that it would be nice if it were balanced
right.
by the hope narrative
yeah.
as well.
Yeah, and informed by the people themselves, right? In what other context do we assume that we know what something is like in the absence of having it, right? When you ask
wait,
caregivers...
Let me just repeat
yeah.
that. In what other situation do we believe that we can understand something even though we don't have it ourselves?
Right.
That's really profound.
Yeah.
Because, so I'm involved with a conference on human rights and dementia, and part of it is we immediately assume that because you've got this diagnosis, I can tell you what to do.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
In many realms of your life.
Yeah.
And as you put it, where does that happen except in childhood?
Right.
You know,
exactly.
It doesn't happen with being in a wheelchair.
Yeah. Classic paternalism or infantilization, whatever academic terms you want to put on it, but it doesn't feel good.
So, some advice. So, once in a while, we have people like you who, on this program who have some advice to give and who've thought about this. Mm-hmm. And if you were to tell the audience, based on this this minute of academic minute, which basically said being labeled is a negative thing in this field, and that the mission of creating a life worth living for all of us as we age, including those with cognitive challenges, can't be followed if we stigmatize people. So what advice would you give people, anybody, to start getting around this negative despair narrative and turning on a little bit of this hope narrative?
Well, I think one of the biggest ways to promote social change is to hear what people with Alzheimer's or cognitive issues have to say, to hear their stories.
So first, listen to other people.
Yes, absolutely. Listen and join them where they are, right? We have this cultural, you know, reticence or fear, as I talk about in that academic minute, to just accept certain kinds of decline. Right. And so I think, you know, I always say, like, I have the best job in the world when I'm in the field and talking to people with Alzheimer's, because I can go and interview one person and they, you know, might at moments think that I, when I've talked to people that were further advanced, that I'm a flight attendant and they're someone that was a pilot their whole life. Or my very first job was in a nursing home where I was a housekeeper. And I loved when some 80-year-old woman would come up to me and say, come on, daddy wants us to sing for him by the fire. And I'd be like, yeah, that's awesome. Let's do that. That sounds like fun. But I was taught by that nursing home not to do that, to say to that person, no, I'm not your sister. You're like 60 years older than me. And your sister's dead.
I want to turn this around to the advice, the positive stuff. So what do you do?
So I would say listen to people. Right. And join them where they are. Let go along with, rather than try to reorient people to our reality,
right?
Which is questionable. Join them where they are. If they, what I think is one of the blessings is that people don't forget their life stories and they don't forget their childhood and their many of their meaningful memories. And so go with them there. And if they want to, if they think you're their sister and want to sing, go for it.
So you said they don't forget the meaningful things.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we end with your advice about meaningful things today? Not only old meaningful things, but new meaningful
Absolutely.
Things.
So I would say you should continue doing things that you find that you get pleasure out of. I don't think you should start doing brain exercises or do things that you don't like doing. I don't think that makes sense. I think you should continue doing those things that you enjoy. I think you should, admit when you have, you know, the people I talk to say, you know, that it's very effective to use humor and to make light of things even, right? And that kind of eliciting sympathy.
I've heard that a lot.
Yeah, so, you know, on the one hand, I would say do this, we talked about this, the same things everyone's told to do, right? It's good, you should eat well, you should exercise, you know, you should sleep well, right? We talked about that. And so, you know, those things are a given, right? But that's the same for all of us. So I think you should continue being who you are and not, you know, withdraw. And this is for older people in general. I think older people should tell their stories.
But that's really, and we can end with that, which is we're getting back to the real meaning, which is as we get older, it doesn't really matter whether we remember something well or not. Mm-hmm. We should have fun. We should use humor.
Yeah.
We should do things that are meaningful to us. Mm-hmm. We should tell our stories.
Yeah.
And we should stop worrying about what we can't do and focus on what we can.
Yeah, I think forget memory.
Forget memory.
I mean, forget that your memory defines who you are. Don't assume.
Because maybe it doesn't. Yeah. And on that note, I will always remember you being here. And but I won't define myself that way.
Okay.
And thank all of you for watching. Thank all of you for being with us during this interview. And I look forward to you joining Hopeful Aging next time. So long.